Previously on Marriage Talks.
When you're saying buying a table, buying a piece of cloth, but this is exactly when he was told by God, your first work is this. You get what I'm saying? And my question is this, is because, and when we talk about talk, let me hit it a little bit further. Instead of just talking, taking decision, because there, Adam was, there was a decision he was supposed to take.
And it was a critical decision.
Yeah. It was a critical decision. And this is exactly where we are in the community. Mm-hmm. You see, like raising the children, it's not whether you want or I want. Mm-hmm. You get, it's a decision that has to be taken by somebody. You get what I'm saying?
Welcome to Marriage Talk Season 4. Join us as we discuss the differences between men and women. We are privileged to host Pastor Tim and Pastor Judy. And for the very first time on Marriage Talks, Pastor Bonnie and Pastor Geraldine. And our very own Pastor Peter and Pauline Kamau. This is Marriage Talks, where our marriages must come to a rest.
Maybe not to bring that issue to a close. Mm-hmm. Obviously, I know there's a lot of points that we need to discuss.
Yeah.
I think we need, number one, also to remember that women make friends easily. Mm-hmm. And I believe that maybe the snake or the serpent was not the first animal that Eve had conversed with. Mm-hmm. Look at women. When they go to a toilet, even in a public toilet, they can still converse and ask, where did you buy that weave? Mm-hmm. What is, you know, they can make friends, or they can converse, make even friends in a public toilet. They can make a conversation. Mm-hmm. When men, we go to a toilet, business, finish your business. If somebody tries to talk to you in the toilet, you think it's about mugging. Mm-hmm. You know, so we don't make friends in the toilet. So women make friends very, very easily. Mm-hmm. And this is even up to today life. So we think that maybe Satan took advantage of that. But now coming to the place of men talking. Mm-hmm. Remember what I said in the beginning, understanding your place, your position, and what is the role. And when you understand your role, then you realize actually for a man to be fully and totally in authority, there's a lot of death, especially to selfishness has to go. Let me give a good example. When I realized, obviously, God had called me in ministry, and my busy schedule, I'm working, I'm also in ministry, and we have a young family here, I realized actually I don't have more time with my children, because maybe in the evening when they're coming, I'm not at home. So I made a decision that I'm the one who will be making breakfast for them every morning. Mm-hmm. I'm the one who's going to drop them to school. Mm-hmm. And if possible, even iron for them. This is not, it's not that what people say that maybe your wife is sitting on you. No. But I made
controlling. Yeah. That's direction.
That's why I use that word. Mm-hmm. So what I meant by this, the reason why I took this decision, because I realize for me to be able to connect with these kids, I need to, there's something that has to go. And I needed to sacrifice. So I made sure that I'm the one who's making the breakfast. And I'm not saying that every man should make the breakfast for their children. But I knew that this is a point of connection. Because when you're eating with their children, when you're cooking for them, especially in the morning, there's that connection. And then I'm driving them to school. Mm-hmm. And I've done that religiously to all of them. Mm. So, and that became the place now I realized it's out of my comfort zone, but I did something that is, I know that in future, it will count. Mm. So what am I saying? For us to be able to take our place, it's not only ruling from the parish, it's mixing with your subjects. As we say, we have a king. Pastor Tim said that there's a king in us. Mm. But if you only rule from the parish without knowing what is going on on the ground, then you miss. And that's why maybe sometimes say that men, even women, sometimes they say men take your position. But sometimes taking our position is because you cannot just come and start controlling that boy or that girl if you have not had an interaction with them. So if we try to give instruction and you have never had an interaction with them, they'll see you as a foreigner, though you're in the same house.
Mm.
So for that child to give you respect, there must be that connectivity. There must be that connection, that is.
Mm.
And there must be, you have an interaction, you know each other.
Mm.
You understand?
Mm.
So by the time you're coming to dish authority as a man, or taking your position as a king in that house, you've already done, laid your life down. And so it is with even your wife. As much as we like our wife to respect us, there must be that laying down of your of your life down. Actually, the Bible says
dying to self.
Dying to self. Even Christ said that in the book of Ephesians chapter 5, that Christ left the church, that he laid his life, he died for the church. Let me give you, we were sharing that discussion before, all of us here. When we were called in ministry, obviously, I didn't know how to go about it. And I thought maybe prayer and the word, you know, that is my calling. And I expected my wife to know that that God first, you are second. And I could go maybe for 4 or 5 days for prayer retreats and even, you know, not even necessarily care. I tell her, don't call me, I'll call you. So, and you see now, I'm taking care of somebody else's bride. Christ, church is a bride of Christ, but I've forgotten the bride that God has given me. And I will not lie to you, our marriage was very shaky in the beginning because I prioritized things that I thought that were godly, yes, but at the expense of my wife. And I remember one day she told me that I'm not enjoying ministry. I'm not enjoying, yes, I love God, but I'm not enjoying, you know, service. Then we had heart-to-heart talk, and then I realized actually something I have to have balance. But what do I balance? So as much as I'm taking care of the church, I'm also taking care of her, spending time with her, listening to her, maybe also making at least 1 week or every other week we have a dinner date. Even not necessarily even going to a park with a box of chips is a dinner. You know, sometimes it's not the place. It is the concept behind.
Yeah.
I'm not saying that you I'm not saying that don't take your wife to fish and chips.
Yeah.
I'm just saying that, you know, but actually that's what started healing our marriage.
Yeah.
And actually it's not that I did not focus on the church, but I realized
there was a balance.
There's a balance.
Yeah.
An intentionality.
Yeah.
And realizing actually that marriage does not just stand by itself.
Yeah.
You can be a man of God and still your marriage can corrupt.
Oh yes.
Yeah.
Even and there are so many of them by
You know, you took critical decisions. You are very intentional that your children needed to hear your voice.
Yeah.
And how can they hear your voice? By you engaging with them.
Yeah.
And engaging with them positively. They see you making breakfast. You take them to school. So in the car, you'll be having conversations with them. So there is a bonding.
Yeah.
That even later, maybe when you're going about the work of the ministry, they still have conversations they can remember. They'll be free to approach you because there is when they get to know who dad is.
Yeah.
So there was a lot of intentionality. When you realize that your focus was so much on the church and the bride that God had given you, you had neglected her. You turned it around by becoming intentional and you took a critical decision. And you said you did not stop serving the church.
Yeah.
You are still serving, but there is an order that you're respecting. You know, they come after God, your wife, your family, then the church follows. You know, so there's that intentionality. And this is what I was saying. So if men are muted, or they mute themselves, then things go wrong, like my husband has said, you know, that there are dire consequences to the life of the family, to the life, you know, so many things are connected. I mean, look at the story of David. I often say, Hollywood, if they need scripts for their movies, they just need to pick up the Bible. The Bible has such scripts with such stories, you know, that they are so impactful that there are so many lessons to be learned, you know. You know, and apart from David, you know, after David passed on and the helm of the kingdom was to be passed on to Solomon, I think there was, is it a different son of David who wanted to overtake Solomon? And then after that, he went and asked for David's
concubine.
Concubine. But do you know that same brother, I'm forgetting his name, Adonijah. Mm. It starts with an A, I wanted to say that. Do you know Adonijah, he also had a son. And the Bible says that Adonijah did not speak anything evil or good or bad to his son as a man. So if even as a man, if you're not talking to your children, whether good or bad, you don't have time to converse and get with your children. You don't have time to rebuke your children. There must be a balance. You can't always be loving.
There must be a balance. And this is the issue. This is the issue. And I'm thinking about, when I'm seated here, I'm trying to think, because having been married for 30 years, whether there was an incident that I wanted to talk. And I was muted.
By me.
Yeah, I'm coming.
Obviously.
But I'm looking this not as from my marriage. Mm-hmm. I'm looking this from a man point of view. Mm-hmm. And I'll speak of one strength that ladies have, but if not used positively, it can mute a man. Whenever a man tries to speak and the woman overpower her with words, overpower him with words, draw him whenever he is. And there are women who are very sharp.
Or manipulate.
Very sharp with their talks. And actually, if a man, because a man, I say sometimes, a man will either react in anger or either me, because you are for peace, and you see, we cannot. There is no way I can compete with my wife when it comes to talking, especially when we are when there is anger. She has words that I don't have. You get what I'm saying?
Like somebody say, if you ever win,
an argument
with your wife, that was halftime. Wait, that was up to halftime. Wait for second half, and you'll see you lose. So that means that you never win any argument with your wife. And as you say, maybe especially in this country, whereby if somebody shouts, you know, the police are coming. I also believe maybe, especially in this country, most men are muted because, number one, you don't want drama. And I'm sorry to say this, that most women can be drama queen when they come to using that, especially the shout, an argument, they can be able to do that very, very well.
Pastor Keriungi, Bishop, the late Bishop Keriungi, used to say that women, if you're not careful, you become hysterical, what you're saying about dramas, and historical. We don't forget. So it's what you're talking about, that, you know, you don't want that drama. It's because of the hysterics that come along in that moment. Sorry, I cut you short.
And actually, when a man realizes you're a drama queen, if you always shout, most of the time they will decide to be mute. So they can, many bad things can go in that form, because they are the men like drama. So they can be silent, not because they don't want to talk, but it's like what I said in the beginning. What is a domino effect of this argument? You understand? And unfortunately, especially in this country, whereby you can find yourself that you're the one who is told, don't 100 meters away from this house. There is actually...
What is it called? Restraining order.
The restraining order. When you realize that there are such a restraining order, so you decide, let me just be quiet. I want peace. And it's not that peace that you want. It's not that type of peace. It's that you don't want drama.
It's not peace at any cost.
So, and very rarely, because maybe sometimes the home you're being restrained, you don't even work for that. Maybe even paid for the mortgage or paying rent, then to be uprooted again. And you see, the main silence is not, there are so many, you know, things that we can look at and say why men are silent. But I believe maybe my
brother,
let me ask Pastor Judy. Now, if the man is muted and he doesn't want issues, you who has, let's technically say you've been used of the devil to mute your husband, do you think you've won? Are we winning, women, when we are muting our husbands because of our own behaviors, because of our own actions, like what Pastor Bonnie is saying? Sometimes even the slightest argument in the home, there's a threat of calling the police on you. you know, here in this country. And you know, when the police come, you'll be told to leave for the night. Then you might be allowed to come back the following day. But that day, you'll have to vacate the family home and go and spend. They give you time out like as though you're a child. The man is given time out. So you see, if the police are called once, twice, you know, thrice, there's a case they are building up.
Mm.
So as women, do you think we are winning just because we are muting and you think you're controlling?
Well, I wouldn't say that there is any victory in muting the men, because you're muting somebody who should be speaking something that grows and builds and adds value to the family. So by shutting that door, what you're doing is that you're denying yourself something that you need. So muting is not the result, or is not a good idea. The idea is to talk about it, and allowing the person to talk doesn't mean that you're entertaining. Exactly. So I think muting with an intention to do evil or to punish is not the best. But muting, that is a strategy to get yourself out, because sometimes they will speak from a place of anger. So when, if for example, the husband does not project or express themselves through shouting back, rather they withdraw, then that is different. So they are muted because that is their strategy of dealing with what has.
Usually that's how they deal with
that
kind of situation. I read something by Dr. Gottman. He has what he calls divorce predictors. And one of the predictors of a family that is about to divorce, and the percentage is very high, like 90%, is that what he calls harsh startups. So if the conversation in the house always starts harshly, so and he says that usually the people who start conversations harshly are women. It's like when you start a conversation, maybe something, it's an issue that needs to be addressed. But how you start that conversation is like, you, I always tell you, you don't think. Then that man, what usually happens to him is that he stonewalls.
Exactly.
He just pulls the walls up. And that conversation ends there. So you can talk, but that man is in his own zone. He has shut you out. So if that is how every conversation, when there is a challenge, starts, then the divorce is just around the corner. And so one of the solutions he was offering is that learn to start the conversation in a calm, respectful way. And asking for a suggestion instead of demanding. So like, if it's something, you know, like start in a nice way. You know, Nahandi, you know, when we say that we do this, why haven't you followed it up? Or we decided this. But don't say, oh, we said the other day, and now look what has happened. Because that will always end up escalating and escalating. If that's how the conversations start in the home. So how we start our conversations when we want to address an issue is very key to us keeping our marriage and our peace in the home.
Just a minute, yeah. Because I may forget. So I'm looking at the background of how maybe most of us are raised now. And maybe if you are raised in a family where you are many, you realize actually maybe, unless maybe somebody lift up his voice, something will not be well communicated. For you to communicate and to be heard is maybe out of raising your voice. And there's a way maybe you are brought up. And that's how maybe naturally you communicate. But unfortunately, when it comes to marriage, when somebody communicates from a point of threatening, you realize actually there's no way we'll ever get a solution, because you've come with an attacking mode, and especially when you approach man with an attacking way,
mm.
they'll always put a defense on them. They lift up their defense, and then it's always fight or fright. And fright doesn't mean that they will necessarily leave the house.
Mm.
But they can stonewall, as my wife said.
Yeah? Mm-hmm.
They can stonewall. And you know exactly, you can be staying in the same house with a man, but he left a long time ago.
Mm-hmm.
But maybe the reason why he's still in the house is because maybe there's a mortgage to pay, maybe
there are children. Yeah.
And unfortunately, the worst thing is when a man has left.
And he's still present.
And he's still present.
Yeah.
Because it's more toxic.
Mm.
Because they can be silent, and it would be, it's not good for anybody.
Mm.
Not the wife, not even for the man himself, not even the children.
Mm.
And I believe if you look at most of the marriage that we see before people divorce, the man actually maybe most likely divorced maybe 5 years ago.
I had somebody say we live with our heart before we live with our feet.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's very true. There was something that you were trying to say, Pastor. Yeah, yes. Pastor Tim.
I wanted to say, I think we touched on it a bit earlier, that inherent in every man is a king, a warrior, a friend, and a lover. You rarely see kings exchanging words just like that. In fact, the king's word was so revered that when they spoke, what they said became law. Jesus Christ is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Sometimes God takes a long time before he speaks, but when he speaks purposefully. And I think inherent in every man's very being is the desire to be respected and to be honored by your wife. And it has to do with all those things that we have said. And whenever a man sees dishonor from far or senses a dishonor from far, they tend to withdraw. Just like kings will not entertain things that will bring dishonor to the office. We live in an era of democracy, and democracy has allowed us to say what we want anytime we want to say it.
Mm-hmm.
But inside every king's heart is a desire for honor.
Mm.
And when that dishonor is around,
yeah.
they just upset themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Secondly, as warriors, if there is something inherent in a warrior is the notion that you should never reveal fear. And so when we communicate differently. Wives or ladies speak through a problem. But men do not speak through a problem. They think through a problem. And when a problem seems too daunting, they are not quick to reveal fear. And so they will withdraw for some time to try and gather their thoughts and try to come up with a solution. And so I think precisely because of our makeup, that's why we tend not to speak and we tend to be quiet. But there's something else maybe I would want to invite us maybe to think through. Could it be that sometimes it's not that we are not quiet, it's that we are not hearing? Because sometimes if you're not listening, you cannot respond. If you're not hearing, you cannot respond. And that has to do with that men and women speak differently.
Mm.
Words are very different, and communication for men and for women is very different. For instance, when women speak, there are two things they employ. One, they speak very emotively. They speak their emotions. They speak through their emotions. We had that earlier with the ladies that they're bringing it up, that when they have a problem, they speak through it, and they will speak it, but men will think through it. But also, secondly, when women speak, sometimes they speak, but what they are saying is not what they are saying.
Actually, I'll add on that.
You understand? So, if you are not careful to listen to what is unspoken, you will only respond to what is spoken.
That's right.
So there are two scenarios. In Genesis chapter 29, there is a relationship between Jacob and Leah.
Mm.
Leah is the most unfortunate character in the Bible. She's called Leah. The word Leah, the name Leah actually means wild cow. I don't know why they called her a cow. Now, can you imagine in your family, Rachel is the beautiful one. You have the eyes that, you know, the Bible describes her as
faint-eyed.
Yeah. So she doesn't have everything going for her.
From the name to the looks.
From the name to the looks. And when it comes to her wedding day, she's given as get one free. You know the way she's like,
buy one,
get one free. Yeah. Rachel is bought, but she's added on top as a get one free.
Yeah.
And so in her family, you see she comes from a disadvantage.
Mm.
And when she got married, all she ever wanted was to be loved.
And to be accepted.
Yeah. But she's communicating these things, but Jacob is nowhere.
Yeah.
And you will notice, when she names her first child, she calls the child Reuben.
Yeah.
Means God hears that I'm not loved.
Yeah.
Then she has another child, names the child Simeon.
Yeah.
God sees.
Yeah.
Then she has another child, calls her Levi.
Yeah.
Now I will be attached.
Yeah.
Three times she's saying, no one sees me. No one hears me. No one is attached to me. But Jacob is not there because he cannot hear what is spoken. He can only hear what is spoken. And that perhaps is one of our undoing, that sometimes we only listen to verbal communication, but ladies are very good at picking what is not being said, but is being said. So, and they tend to think we are quiet, but we are not quiet. Then she had another one. And she called her the name Judah.
Judah.
This time I will praise the Lord. Yeah. So she stopped thinking about pleasing men, and then she stopped giving birth. In other words, she found acceptance from God. And when she found acceptance from God, she stopped caring about what people thought about her. But most people are looking for admiration, acceptance, all those things, but they are not getting. If you go to Genesis chapter 30, now, Rachel sees how the sister has been blessed with babies. And then she comes to the husband, Jacob, and says, give me a child or I'm going to die. Jacob listens to the wife. He's listening to what is verbal, but he's not hearing what is not being said. Because he answers back and says, Am I God?
Mm.
You see, what he's doing now is he's responding in the defensive because he's only responding to the verbal. But really, he should attend to what is not being spoken.
Mm-hmm.
What was not being spoken? I need to be assured that it is okay.
Mm-hmm.
I need acceptance. I need an affirmation. Why? My sister has just given 4 children.
Mm-hmm.
And you say, I'm the beautiful one that is the apple of your eye.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't have a child. So I need assurance from you. But
and let's go back to what you were talking about, you know, about one of the needs of ladies.
Mm-hmm.
Affirmation.
Yeah.
Affirmation. And let me see. I know you want to talk, yeah? But there is one question. And what you have said is just a reason by itself. But there is something, please allow me. There is something that Sister Pastor Geraldine said. I want to go back before we come back to where you are. You said especially when you start to talk in a harsh manner. In a harsh manner.
Harsh startup.
And yesterday I was looking at Proverbs 25:24,
mm-hmm.
where the Bible says it's better to stay on a top of a roof than to stay in the same house
with
a nagging wife.
Mm-hmm.
And probably before we judge whether somebody is nagging or not, I went to the dictionary to know who is a nagging wife.
Who is a nag.
All right then. And this is what the Bible says in Webster dictionary. It's somebody who is constantly harassing somebody.
Mm-hmm.
And then what it defines even further, it can come in the form of asking question, comments, or criticism.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's what define a nagging person.
Mm-hmm.
You get what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And just before, I'll just throw this to us and then we're gonna go back to what Pastor Timothy was saying. And then I asked myself one question. I know we are crossing this, especially for this as I say, could it be if I'm constantly criticized? Constantly comments are made negative comments. You know, asking questions constantly. You are pushing me to a place where
My rich door.